Hi, everyone. This is Sarah, one of your hosts. Recording this podcast involves multiple people, each sequestered in their own homes with different microphones and recording environments. As a result, some of the audio might be difficult to understand. We've done what we can to make the show sound good, and we aim to get better. Thanks for your patience and enjoy the show.
Hi, I'm Sarah Glassberg.
I'm Brad Pilcher.
And this is AJFF in Conversation, the podcast where we talk about all things Jewish cinema. And in this episode, we are going to be offering up just some food for thought, Jewish food, that is.
There's probably going to be a lot of food puns in this episode, just as fair warning.
Yeah, that's probably a safe bet. I know I, for one, love making puns, especially puns about food, because I also love food. But anyway, when we're not making terrible food puns, we are going to be unpacking a couple of key questions, like what is the relationship between food and the Jewish experience, and how has that been cooked up on the movie screen?
We'll be discussing some quintessential Jewish foods, what role they play in cinema, and of course, in order to do that, we'll be highlighting some of the most memorable moments and prominent representations of Jewish food in film.
And as much as I am a huge foodie and so obsessed with this topic, I have to admit I am not an expert on Jewish food culture or how that often gets translated to the screen.
Well, I am not a foodie at all, as you will very clearly find out in a moment. So to help us out with this particular episode, we have a special guest who is much better equipped to speak about all things culinary, Shannon Sarna. She is an old friend of mine from college. And she is also the founding editor of The Nosher. She's the co-host of the podcast Call Your Mother. She's a contributing writer to Kveller.com, all part of 70 Faces Media. But she is also the author of the cookbook Modern Jewish Baker, and her writing and recipes have appeared in Taste of Home magazine, Bake from Scratch magazine, Parade magazine, New Jersey Monthly magazine, Tablet magazine, so many others. She lives in New Jersey with her husband and her three kids, two rescue dogs, and a bunny named S'mores, apparently. Shannon, thank you for helping us understand Jewish food and for being with us today.
Hi, guys. Thanks for having me. My bunny named S'mores is a really important part of our family's identity and my bio, obviously.
How did you come to name your bunny S'mores?
I did not. And actually, S'mores' full name related to my cookbook is S'mores Rugelach, named by my 7-year-old daughter.
That sounds like a very good name. And you should give your 7-year-old daughter a prize or something for picking it.
I'm not going to give her a prize. I'm taking care of the bunny. She gets to keep the bunny. That's the prize.
Yeah. Is S'mores her favorite food, or is Rugelach her favorite food? You're 7.
Neither. I think he just kind of looks like a s'mores. And so that's how she came up with the name. He's kind of like black and white.
Well, it's a food themed episode. So why don't we start by going around the table a little bit and just sort of talking about what our favorite foods actually are. Sarah, do you want to start?
Sure. How much time do I have? Okay. No. So favorite food in general, probably mac and cheese. So, you know, a comfort food, not necessarily Jewish. To get us, I guess, on topic, my favorite Jewish food has got to be bagels. I have loved bagels my whole life. I can eat them every day. I could eat them for more than one meal a day, if that was socially acceptable. And I love lox. I love egg and cheese. I love cream cheese. Just bagels, bagels, bagels. I think when I was still a meat eater, I'm a pescatarian now, I might have said a really good pastrami sandwich. But yeah, I'm going to go with bagels, my lifelong food love, carb love.
But Sarah, as a former New Yorker, can you find good bagels in Atlanta?
Again, how much time do we have? So yes, actually, this is one of my favorite things to do is friends or family who visit us here in Atlanta.
We definitely take them to some of our favorite restaurants, my husband and I, again, huge foodies. And I've had family from New York and his family's from Jersey, actually. And we've taken them to Goldberg's Bagels, and all of our family members were just so surprised at how good the bagels were. There's also a place called Emerald City Bagels, which is super, super satisfying. They have the best gravlax and the best everything bagels anywhere, I would say.
I've heard of them, actually. That's great to hear.
Yeah, it was opened up, actually, by a mother-daughter pair from New York. So it's definitely got an old New York kind of vibe to it.
Shannon, what's your favorite food?
Well, so I'm actually a pizza bagel myself. I'm half Italian, half Jewish. So my favorite Italian food is gnocchi, which are like potato pasta or potato dumplings. And my favorite Jewish food, I might say challah, but I think it's really chicken soup with matzo balls. It's like a quintessential comfort food. Everyone loves chicken soup with matzo balls. And for me, it really connects me to my family. It's one of the few Jewish dishes I grew up with that has always been delicious. My family has varying culinary skill, and some of the Jewish food I grew up with wasn't actually so good, but I always loved matzo ball soup. Brad, do you have a favorite food?
I do have a favorite food. I should say just very clearly right up top that I am a food dunderhead. I converted to Judaism, so I didn't grow up with Jewish food culture. I didn't grow up with any food culture. I came from the whitest English, Irish, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant background. Food was not a cultural thing. I didn't grow up in like an Italian family or a Greek family or any family that had any kind of real food culture. So I just was a meat and potatoes guy. And so when I converted to Judaism, you know, I love brisket. It's the closest thing to what I ate when I was a kid in the world of Jewish cuisine. But it also means that I have essentially no palate. I don't know what's good and what's not. I have been to New York. I have had bagels in New York. I have come back to Atlanta. I have eaten Atlanta bagels. I could not tell you the difference. I do not know anything about the subject. I am going to embarrass myself greatly tonight. It's going to be a lot of fun for me. But that is my favorite food, and it's something that everybody should know up front.
That Brad has no taste.
I have no taste. I have no palate. I have no knowledge of food. I don't know anything about this subject.
Brisket's a good one. Brisket is also so beloved.
Brisket is good. Brisket's hard to, like, you could screw it up, but I've never had it screwed up. With matzo ball soup, which I like matzo ball soup too. My problem with matzo ball soup, Shannon, is that it's very inconsistently prepared. And so sometimes you just get a giant matzo ball with a lot of broth and maybe like a carrot, like a slice of a carrot. And sometimes you get like a really robust, lots of chicken, lots of noodles, lots of stuff. And then like, you know, medium sized or tiny sized matzo balls, and you get everything in between. And it's very frustrating because I do like it, but you know.
Well, I don't know if Shannon, I don't know if you would find this kind of blasphemous in some way, but I thought it was so interesting that you said chicken soup with matzo balls, because again, as a pescatarian, we'll get, you know, the sort of store-bought matzo ball mix, and we'll just get vegetable broth and we'll throw in some carrots and things like that. And I mean, it gets the job done, but it's definitely not as satisfying as, you know, I'm one of those pescatarians or vegetarians that really loves meat and kind of misses it, but you know, I don't eat it. But I don't know, maybe part of what we could talk about today is just kind of how much we can make these things our own and what that really means for, you know, Jewish food traditions and culture and all that.
Food is always evolving, and the entire story of Jewish food is one of evolution. So I'm very pro making your matzo balls the way that you like them and putting them in the receptacle that you most want. Chicken soup with matzo balls is most classic, but that doesn't mean it's the only right way.
So I'm going to take advantage of this moment when I am surrounded by more food experts than I am usually surrounded by. And I am going to ask about a scene in a movie that involves food that I have always been confused by, because it actually lends itself quite naturally to the question of, is there a right way? Is there a wrong way to prepare certain things? In the movie When Harry Met Sally, there is a classic scene in a diner where she fakes an orgasm, and that is not the scene that I want to talk about necessarily today. There's a scene before that where she and Billy Crystal are on a road trip right at the beginning of the movie. They stop in a diner, and they order some food on their way from, I think, Chicago to New York, and she gives the most complicated order you could possibly give for what should be a very simple, simple meal. And Billy Crystal is blown away. And here's the thing that I'm confused by, and I would like hopefully some help on this. he is clearly the Jew in this situation. He is coded as Jewish. I don't think it's ever explicitly said, but he's Jewish. She is not. I think it's very clear that she is coded as Gentile, but she is being the neurotic one, which is typically the Jewish stereotype. So what is going on in this scene? Why is this scene playing out this way? What am I missing? What am I misunderstanding about this particular scene in this very, very iconic movie?
So there, the order, what she orders, right, is a turkey sandwich with coleslaw on the side. That's the...
I think that's what she orders when she fakes the orgasm. Because he has... She has turkey on white. He has corned beef on rye at the scene when they... And the orgasm scene, the faking it scene, was at Katz's Deli on the Lower East Side in New York.
Right.
And,
I forget, what does she order at the diner?
She orders like a salad and a pie a la mode. And she and it's the pie that she goes crazy with. Like, she's like, I want a salad, but I want the oil or the whatever on the side, and I want this pie, but I want the a la mode off the. I want the pie heated, but I don't want the ice cream on it. I want the ice cream on the side, but if I only want strawberry ice cream. If you don't have strawberry ice cream, then just whipped cream. But if you don't have whipped cream coming out of a can, I don't want. It's like, I can't follow it. I have to like go back and rewatch the scene and pay very close attention.
I never interpreted this scene as one of something explicitly about Jewish identity or not. I thought it was just like a stereotypically female way to order. If you heard me order my coffee, like, I would probably sound as crazy as her, but I'm no film buff. So
piggybacking off of that, and I also want to take a second to say, the deli scene, the other scene that we've been kind of referring to, we are honestly going to probably have to do a whole separate episode about Jewish delis in film, because there's just so much there, not just in this scene, but so many other awesome films that we could talk about that we don't have time to talk about today. So I just wanted to kind of put that out there. And then as far as the diner scene, I'm going to agree with Shannon here. I showed myself as a David Wayne fan in the last episode of our podcast, but he has this parody of rom-coms called They Came Together. And there's a really similar scene in there where Amy Poehler, the non-Jewish character in this kind of rom-com scenario, and it's very over the top, but she has this insanely complicated, unrealistically complicated order at a coffee shop. And the Jewish character, the male kind of romantic lead for her, is Paul Rudd. And, you know, so I was thinking about that when I rewatched this scene in When Harry Met Sally, and I suppose both interpretations can be seen as kind of problematic, but I agree. I think it's just meant to be this other trope of the woman being more high maintenance, and maybe, you know, this Jewish character, maybe it's a confidence thing. He just knows what he wants to order, and it's not about neuroses, but it's just about having that confidence in the food that you want to eat, the food that you like when you go to a place like a diner or a deli.
It is a weird film, and you're probably right. And I'm not sure if it's not worse that the trope is about women and not Jewish neuroses, because we'll leave that alone for the episode on feminism.
Maybe something for another episode.
Yeah, we can talk about feminism. Well. But I mean, it's interesting film because it's food is kind of central to some of its iconic scenes. But when you're used to seeing like Woody Allen films and films with neurotic Jews, and you see Billy Crystal in this film, who again, not explicitly Jewish in the film, but he's clearly Jewish. He's never not confident. It is an interesting dynamic to see play out.
And see, as I think about her order, I just think that's a lady who knows exactly how she likes her pie, right?
There's like knowing how you like your pie, and then there's like, are you serious? Are you that persnickety about it, I guess?
If you invite me for coffee, I'll be like, okay, well, what kind of coffee? Do you have half and half? Oh, do you only have milk? Okay, but do you have a milk frother? Okay, well, I can have the 2% milk if you have a milk frother. You don't have either? Forget it. I'll just have tea.
I'm officially only offering you tea when you come to my house.
Noted.
Hey, I mean, this is Nora Ephron, right? Maybe, again, a little off topic from food, but maybe it isn't as much about her neuroses, and maybe it's more just like she knows what she wants. Maybe it's two different brands of confidence, again, in kind of what
I love that, Sara.
What they want to eat, you know? They just don't know what they want when they get to the table.
That is a much more positive spin on it, and I appreciate that. But let's back up for a second, because I actually... that's that one film, that's that one scene. But and again, didn't grow up with food culture, so I'm an idiot. But what is food? Like, what is... I mean, you have to eat it. To me, food is like the thing that you have to eat so you don't die, so you try to get food that you like the taste of. But beyond that, like, why is food so important in culture? Why is food so special, particularly in Jewish culture? Maybe Shannon, you can shed some light on this. Because to me, when I watch films about food or films where food is very central, it's always doing something very, very purposeful and very, very clear in the movies. But I don't necessarily understand why food is so important culturally.
Right. There's like this saying, and I'm notoriously bad at reciting idioms, but there's the saying is that, like, there's two kinds of people who live to eat and people who eat to live. And I think, Brad, you're obviously the kind of person who just eats to live. But for me, like, being from two ethnic families, like, food is so central. And it's not just Jewish families or Italian families for whom food is central, right? Like, it's Mexican families. It's Greek families. It's Russian families. Food is literally gathering around the table with your family. Food is love. It's how you express affection. It's how you relate to your community. It's where you come from. I mean, to me, it's like everything. And I think there's a uniquely Jewish part of that. And there's a more universal part of it also that relates to so many other ethnic groups for whom food is so central.
And it makes sense. And one of the things that has always jumped out to me when I've watched films is, for some reason, it's always about the mom, like mom's cooking. And I'm like, all right, well, part of that is just because women were always the ones who are cooking, and that's their traditional sort of patriarchal role, which is its own bag of problems. But it always struck me when I would watch, there's the documentary, In Search of Israeli Cuisine, which is a film we had at the festival a couple of years ago. We'll talk about it a little bit more, but you know, you're watching this film and every time they talk about food with every chef they talk to, it's like, yeah, it's about when I was growing up, my mom's kitchen, my mom's food, the food my mom taught me how to make.
Yeah. And grandmas were referenced a lot in that film as well.
Yeah. And, you know, I guess it goes back to family. It makes sense that food would draw you back to your roots in that way, that's what you had at home. But it does, I guess for me, what has always been challenging is that part makes sense. The part where food becomes a vehicle for power relationships or a vehicle for trying to bring people together in a way that it has sort of this power in films like In Search of Israeli Cuisine or Abe, which is another film we had at last year's festival, which is all about a kid who's trying to bring his inter-ethnic, half Palestinian, half Jewish family together through food. It's like, it's a tool, but it's just like, okay, well, I get it. Like, if there's a nostalgia factor when you go back to what you grew up with as a kid, what your family ate, what your parents made for you, but it doesn't, I guess for me, it's never had that power, that ability to sort of be used as a tool in the same way as, you know, clearly it is for other people. And clearly it is for people who eat to live as opposed to live to eat.
I think that food is a connector. And I think in bringing people together, I mean, it's a common language. Even if you don't have other things in common, you're like, most people love to eat, right? Like, so in that way, I think that it can be a common ground. It's something that everyone enjoys. And also it's something that everyone has a story about, or most people have a story about, you know, a smell that connects them to their mother or grandmother's kitchen, you know, the holiday dish, at whether it's at Christmas or it's at Hanukkah or it's at Passover, that, you know, the holiday just wouldn't be the same without that dish. I get that very much. And I get it from really both parts of my family. Something that, that Solomonov talks about in the film In Search for Israeli Food and Cuisine is kind of about his grandmother's barakas, and that he wanted to take them off the menu after his grandmother died, because he didn't want anybody commenting on them, right? You know, all this like honoring of his grandmother. And I thought it was I really understood that. It really spoke to me. But whether it's your grandmother's breakup, your mom's eggplant parm, right? Like, we all have those food memories that speak so much to us. And then they tell a deeper story of where we came from and how those foods traveled with us.
In Search of Israeli Cuisine, for those who have not seen the film, which is free for Amazon Prime subscribers. So if you haven't seen it, you should absolutely watch it. It's a really good documentary.
Also, Brad gets a kickback from Amazon Prime every time he says that.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what we do. Kickbacks are our friends. So that documentary is very interesting to me because I think you're absolutely right when you talk about, you know, food has this power for a lot of people. Not me, but clearly for a lot of people. But when I was watching that particular documentary, which follows the chef restaurateur Michael Solomonoff around Israel talking about food traditions in that country, and it's a very young country, so it's arguable that it hasn't been around long enough to have its own cuisine. That's a sort of key question in the film. But to me, what was a much more interesting key question in the film was the question of how much Israeli cuisine was just reappropriating Arab cuisine and claiming it as Israeli. And it becomes a point of contention for some people in that documentary. So as someone who knows all about food culture and the history of food a little bit, Shannon, how much of these kind of cultural appropriations and associations that we have with food, Italian food or Jewish food or Israeli food, and especially Jewish food, because Jewish food, there's Ashkenazi Jewish food, Sephardic Jewish food, it's essentially the food of wherever the diaspora was moving at that moment. How much is it just reappropriation and how much of it is authentically Jewish cuisine?
So in terms of Israeli food, I will say, number one, I think Israeli food is in the process of defining its cuisine. And in that process, of course, it has brought in foods, Jewish food, from all over the world, all of the people who have come to Israel and brought their flavors. We're still going to continue to see how that develops. Many of the people who came to Israel lived in countries primarily that were Arab, Arab Christian, Arab Muslim. And so the food they were eating might, by others, be considered, quote unquote, Arab foods. New Syrian Jews eat food that is remarkably similar to Syrian Christian and Syrian Muslims. So I think it's sort of a complicated question. The best parallel I like to make is that, you know, in the United States, we define Jewish food almost exclusively as Ashkenazi food, right? If you ask the average person, what is Jewish food? They would say pastrami. They would say matzo ball soup. Maybe they might say latkes or kugel. These are all Eastern European foods, which in many cases aren't exclusively Jewish foods. They were foods that Jews adopted and adapted in Austria, Germany, Russia, Poland. You know, these were not exclusively Jewish foods. Matzo ball soup, yes, maybe. So many others, babka, kreplach, even rugelach, these were not, even hamantaschen, which we so closely associate with Purim, these were just things that people in Eastern Europe were eating and Jews adopted them while they were living there. You know, my favorite dish growing up and was what my great-grandfather fed my father, and it's what my mother-in-law's favorite dishes is egg noodles with cottage cheese. It's like Polish peasant food. And I had a friend whose family was Catholic from Poland, and she ate the same thing. So while Jewish families in America consider this, you know, this sort of like Jewish mac and cheese, egg noodles and cottage cheese as this quintessential Jewish dish of their childhood and upbringing, it's actually not really Jewish at all. So I think the parallel argument can be made in many cases for some of the things that people will point to in Israeli food culture to say, like, that is not a Jewish food. That is an Arab food. You stole that food. It's simply not true in many, many cases. It's just happened to be what Jews were eating in the countries that they came from, and they brought it to Israel. There are other foods, I would say, particularly around hummus and falafel, that are certainly food of the Levant that became popularized as Israelis tried to further Israelicize themselves, right? They wanted to define themselves as Israeli, and that meant not eating European food. It meant eating the food of Israel, which was falafel. But what Israelis have done is to take what was the food around them, and they've so much made it their own. And I think in that way, those are the places that we see how Israeli food is defining itself, right? It's not the same bowl of hummus that you make at, you know, in Lebanon. It's Israeli version, right? It's not the same falafel that you get on a plate. It's This very beautiful and vibrant falafel stuffed into pita is the part that is uniquely Israeli.
I don't mean to make another food pun here, but it sounds to me like a lot of what defines Jewish food or what can count as Jewish food has so much to do with what you're bringing to the table. And I think from what you're saying, and this is, I guess, just me hypothesizing almost and thinking about films like Abe, just going back to that for a second, arguably my favorite film that we had in this past AJFF. I'm just thinking about like how much these things don't actually have borders, it sounds like, how much they're able to be malleable or evolving, as you said before. I'm thinking about how in Abe, falafel comes into play a lot. There are all these arguments about, you know, is this a Palestinian food originally? And what I love about Abe specifically is it doesn't make those arguments pointless. You know, I think that there's a lot of contention and obviously conversations that happen in that film that are, you know, I think worthy of having, but what Abe, you know, in the film does, and he's played by Noah Schnapp, and I think part of what makes this film work so well is just he's so genuine in his performance of this kid that, again, tries to use food to bring his family together. But specifically, he's making fusion food. And so is this still Jewish food if he's melding all of these different influences together? And I think it still counts. And I don't know. I'm also thinking about, we had a short film about the kosher barbecue festival that takes place here in Atlanta. And I think we can even look at a film like that from a friend of the festival, local filmmaker Adam Hirsch, and really look at what role that festival plays in the Jewish community here in Atlanta and say, yeah, barbecue can even be, you know, a Jewish food, I think.
It's very clear to me that nobody but Jews eat gefilte fish, though, right, Shannon? Like, that's not a food that anybody, any other culture wanted. They were like, you guys can have it. It's good. Am I wrong? Please tell me I'm not wrong.
I think the only culture that might eat fish in weirder ways than Jews is probably the Russians. Have you ever heard of herring in an overcoat or shuba?
No.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you can Google it after this.
Well, I think parts of Germany and like Nordic countries also eat fish in kind of interesting ways. I spent a weekend in Hamburg, and admittedly, I love the sort of brat herring that you can get while eating next to the river in Hamburg. But yeah, I think maybe this points again to the fact that a lot of these foods, you can find similar ones, if not the exact same ones, in a lot of those different European countries.
Well, I'll just, back to your point, Sarah, I would say that I'm not so obsessed with defining what is or isn't Jewish food. I know people sort of like to play that game, but I've of the mindset that like it almost really doesn't matter, and that, you know, if a food is stagnant and standing still, like it's going to die, or it will be boring and irrelevant. I'm always very excited to see how food can, you know, be fused and innovated upon. I'm not asking the question like, "But is it Jewish food?" Because I just don't think that's the important question to ask.
Oh, now so, you tell us. I'm joking.
No, not at all. Just, you know,
joking. But
I have the opposite question though, I want to end on this question, because to me it's a really fascinating part of both Abe and In Search of Israeli Cuisine, both of which are films that on some level are trying to explore the idea that food can bring people together across cultural barriers. There's a lot of talk in Search of Israeli Cuisine about how when you go into a kitchen and you cook and you sort of take part in the local food, that's a way of getting to know the local people, and obviously Abe is entirely about using food to bring warring aspects of a family together. And it's actually a trope of food reality television that I've always found interesting, because I'm not 100% sure it works in reality, but there's this idea that if you go and you explore the cuisine of a culture, that you somehow will gain a deeper understanding of the culture, and that the barriers, the differences between you and that culture will somehow fall. And in Judaism, at least, the one thing that I do know about the laws of kashrut and Jewish food and the sort of historical reasoning behind that entire tradition was it was as much an attempt to keep Jews segregated and separate from the larger culture when they were in the diaspora as it was anything else. So it was actually almost the opposite. There were all these rules about how to eat this food, and it was as much about making it virtually impossible to bring people into that environment who weren't already Jewish as anything. So I'm curious, does it actually work? Because in Abe, it's questionable to me if it's actually successful, if the food itself has anything to do with bringing these family members together. In Search for Israeli Cuisine, it's a very, very sort of, it's a very open-ended question. It doesn't really resolve it. So I'm curious what you two think. Is food really able to bridge these kinds of tensions, these kinds of conflicts, these kinds of cultural divides that exist, you know, not between people who don't really know anything about each other and don't really care about each other, but people who genuinely have real issues with each other? Is food really able to bridge that gap?
I think it's less about the food itself, and that's coming from a foodie, but I do think it's less about the food itself, and it's more about what the food symbolizes. It's more about how we can come to food. Is this, as Shannon was saying earlier, it has the potential, at least, to be this communal experience and something that you share with others. And when you're having that kind of shared experience, I think it humanizes the people that you're sharing that experience with.
Yeah.
And on top of that, I think bringing back this idea of Jewish food as being always evolving and not necessarily even one set thing, one firm, you know, unchanging, definable thing. I think that food has this potential to always change and always point to a future. And I think that's what, in Abe in particular, I think that's what brings the family together. There is a scene, and I don't think this is too much of a spoiler, but, you know, there is a scene where the family is sort of forced to, again, humanize each other. And it's over a meal, and it's so beautiful. And I think what they realize is that Abe kind of symbolizes the future because of what he's doing with food. But more than that, he's, you know, experimenting and finding ways to change food and to take traditions and influences from the past and from his different sides of his family, but in making something new, that's sort of a forward thinking thing that is really inspiring. And I think that's all of those meanings. I know it seems maybe like a reach for if you're like a eat to live person and a live to eat person, but I really think that food symbolizes all of that.
I would just say in general that I am a believer that food brings people together. And at the very least, food is a wonderful opening for conversation. Because maybe with the exception of Brad, most people love to eat, love to cook, love to share their food memories. And I think it opens them up to dialogue in a way that, you know, maybe another topic of conversation wouldn't. So I am a believer. Maybe I'm just, you know, romantically optimistic about the power of food.
You both have won me over. So maybe there's some hope for us all. Yet, as long as we stay hungry, which is a safe bet. And that may be a good place to leave it on. We've had a lot of food for thought, just to get one more pun into the conversation. And if you're like me at this point, you're hungry. So we're going to let everyone go and eat and do their thing before we come back in a couple of weeks.
Yep. We are your hosts, Sarah Glassberg
and Brad Pilcher.
So producing are Catherine Crosby and Chris Holland, who is also our technical director and editor.
Thank you again to our very special guest this week, Shannon Sarna. The music you've been humming to all show long is by the incomparable Joe Alterman. Please look him up wherever you get your music.
And if you are indeed hungry and want to support the Atlanta Jewish Film Festival's wonderful restaurant partners by ordering takeout or delivery for your next movie night at home, please visit ajff.org for more information. They are such an integral part of our community, so please consider supporting them during these very difficult times in any way that you can.
You can always find more from us as well as show notes at ajff.org/inconversation. Our email address is inconversation@ajff.org.
Please don't forget to subscribe in your podcast app of choice or check out our YouTube channel for new episodes. Give us a rating, a review. Every little bit helps.
And of course, please always tell your friends. Until next time, goodbye.